Hello friends, this is our 15th lecture on culture and anarchy by Matthew Arnold. Now this is chapter 4, we have completed now 1, 2 and 3. Chapter 4, Hebraism and Hellenism. You know, in simple language, Hebraism means moral impulses, the moral fiber. You can say moral impulses or moral fiber of human beings, and Hellenism is intellectual impulses. One is moral, the other is intellectual. Hebraism is strict observance of law, self-conquest, self-devotion in following the will of God. That's the thing. Law establishes the law. St. Paul says, no, establishes the law. Obedience is fundamental. Obedience is fundamental. Obedience to what? Obedience to the law. And the interesting thing is that in Hebraism you find strictness of conscience. So that Christianity, as St. Paul has already said, establishes the law. And then you will find that the Hebrew notion of felicity is, blessed is the man that feareth the eternal, that delights greatly in his commandments, God's commandments, law, and a network of prescriptions. What should you do now? What should you do on Sabbath later? For every moment of his life. So you can say this is a network of laws. Or you can say a labyrinth of laws, where each and every moment of your life is prescribed. What should you do? At what time? And the dominant idea is obeying the will of God, living according to the will of God. That's it. But then what about Hellenism? Hellenism is actually, the uppermost idea of Hellenism is to see things as they really are, not through the prism of morality. See things as really are. The uppermost idea of Hellenism is conduct. The uppermost idea of Hellenism is seeing intellectual, so to say, intellectual. Seeing things as they are. This is reason is the uppermost, I can say. Intelligence. The basis of right practice is intelligence according to Hellenism. The ardent sense for all the new and changing combinations. Combinations, and though all those things that help the development of man brings with it. The indomitable impulse to adjust them perfectly. To know them, to know what are the things that help you to develop, individual as well as the society. Not much about morality and religion and will of God. There's no place for will of God there. It's actually, we can see Hellenism is later on, in the later philosophies, you can see existentialism. We speak of existentialism. That is man being for himself. Being for himself, that is man. His existence. Not this morality and other things like that. Both these are native in man. Both these are necessary. The desire for reason and the desire to follow the will of God. The feeling after the universal order. That is the love of God. So that is both are actually, we can say it is the two driving forces against. Two driving forces, Hellenism and Hebraism. Two driving forces of the empire of man. That's the thing. The difference is Hebraism takes its name from the Semitic race and Hellenism from the Greeks. That's all. The Greeks clarity of thinking, that's understand. The other people, they get the other Hebraism, it goes through, or you can see, it is three things through the prism of the will of God and law. You can see that both Hellenism and Hebraism are admirable and profound manifestations of man's life. Both are. Because without order you cannot live, without law you cannot live. You have to observe laws of life. Otherwise, what will happen? Anarchy. We are, after all, our subject matter is cultural anarchy. So for a perfect person, perfection, best reason, the right reason, the higher development, both are necessary. You cannot say one is important, the other is unimportant. That you cannot say. The crowning aim of both, you can say, the crowning aim of both, same. When the man's perfection, the best self, and the right reason, that is a cultured being. So both will help you to become cultured being. Matthew Arnold says, according to him, he has got some preference for Hellenism. He says, Hellenism is full of sweetness and light. What does that mean? Sweetness and light, you have seen in the first chapter. Yeah. And what does Socrates say? He quotes Socrates. He says, the best man is he who tries to perfect himself. If you try to perfect yourself, then you are the best man. So for perfection, you need both. And the happiest man is he who most feels that he is perfecting himself. I told you, your study of culture and anarchy, not only for culture and anarchy, but for a lot of other things. Like this one, see? You can quote, this in places where you are advising your students, or when you are thinking of yourself. Students as themselves, you can see. The best man is he who tries to perfect himself. The happiest man is he who most feels that he is perfecting himself. So in your studies you can apply this. The happiest student is he who feels that he is spending all he is sincerely studying his lessons. So he's the happiest man. The happiest student. Listen. That is, Hebraism, the problem with Hebraism is it is obsessed with the sin. Humans are the captives of sin. It's too much, no? That's the extreme. So Hebraism is obsessed with the sin. I can see the space which a sin fills in Hebraism is prodigious. Too much and many. Old Testament and New Testament put together, you can see. Old Testament disciplines. The discipline of Old Testament is, what is it? Tendency teaching us to abhor and flee from sin. So you can see this the incidents, the events in Old Testament. Sodom, Gomorrah, the floods. What are these? They are exterminating the people because the writer of Old Testament, the author of war, cannot say single author, or writers of Old Testament, for them they abhor sin. So the Gomorrah, the story, and also the floods, at the time of Noah. See, that's it. What is it after all? Some punishments, the wrath of God. Because the dominant idea of Old Testament is that you must discipline yourself and you should, and also teaching us to abhor and flee from sin. The continuation of that you will find in New Testament. It is a discipline teaching us to die to it. Better to die than to sin. These are extreme views. Better to die than sin. Isn't it? And you can see statements like this. If your eyes If your eyes cause you to sin, then what should you do? You should remove it and throw it away. If it is hands scandal, cut your hands off. If your legs, cut your legs off. There is no in between. If you think that your fingers cause you to sin, cut all the fingers. There is absolutely no option. Either you have or you don't have. Understand, that is the type of teaching that Old Testament and also the continuation of the discipline teaching us. What are the discipline? It says, speaks of becoming conscious of sin, all the sin. Man is an unhappy and a chained captive. So Old Testament as well as New Testament. There's no such thing in Hellenism. Hellenism is happy and gay. At the same time, of course, it's discipline. Discipline. You must perfect yourself, and also you should feel that you are perfecting yourself. That's a different thing. But this is another thing. This is too much of that. So it says captive, an epistle of St. Paul, you can say St. Paul's epistle 3. And in St. Augustine's Confessions. And the two books, you know, imitation. Two books of imitation. Loaded with this idea of sin. And not only the sin that we commit, but this what is called the concept of original sin. And what is that? You are born. The moment you are born, you are in sin. You have no volition. Nothing has happened. You did not do anything, but you are sin. You are a sinner. So the cure for that is baptism. Baptism. There's no such thing in Hellenism. And also we know there is too much to say now. A newborn baby is a sinner. Whatever theological reasons we can give, it's very difficult to understand. And very difficult to follow that also. So self-conquest, if you are following, you can follow. You have no objection, but the thing is that I am talking in this context of culture and anarchy, and also the opinion given by Matthew Arnold. This is not a theology, this is Matthew Arnold's views. So he says self-conquest, self-sacrifice, sin and penance. Series of things like that. Self-conquest, you have to conquer yourself. See? You have to constantly fight against your body. You have to constantly fight against the Satan. You have to constantly fight against your... You have to declare a war on yourself. On Satan and also on the world. The world. God created the world and said, it is good. Everything is good. But Hebraism says that everything is sin. This is what we get from, the idea that we get from Matthew Arnold. See, I am not... When I am talking to you in this way, please do not misunderstand that it is my opinion. No. Not at all. My opinion, why should I say here? There's no point in telling my opinion here. This is not the place where I should say my opinion. No. I'm just quoting and presenting before you the views expressed by Matthew Arnold in his book. Published in 1869, Culture and Anarchy, Chapter 4, Hebraism and the Hellenism. That's all. Please don't, I am detached from this. As far as the ideas expressed in this, I am detached. I am just talking to you about this. So, Matthew Arnold says that this Hebraism is loaded with the idea of sin. You have to somehow get rid of it. You have to get rid of the chain, you have to get rid of the burden of sin, you have to fight a battle that is a constant battle against three enemies of yours. Your world is an enemy, your body is an enemy to you, and also your another person somewhere, Satan. That is the concept of Old Testament and New Testament and St. Augustine's Confessions and also imitation. You can see. Symbols, symbols like this. This, of course, they give cure for this belief in Jesus Christ, God. You have to declare that He is your Savior and so on. That's a different thing. But those things don't come in here. From then that will be religion. So such things won't come in here. But this, we are just speaking about the ideas contained in this chapter. But Hellenism, what does it speak? It speaks of thinking clearly, seeing things in their essence and beauty. That's the difference. So Hebraism says that you should fight against the world. But Hellenism says that it is, you have to think, you see the beauty around it, beauty of this world, as a grand and precious feat for man to achieve. There are grand and precious feats for man to achieve. This opportunity is given to you in this world. The world is full of opportunities. So it is up to you to make use of them. Hellenic nature of human, Hellenic concept of humanness, and that is, seems sound according to Matthew Arnold. Because the other thing is loaded with negativism. See, but this one is, no, the world is beautiful and you have got wonderful opportunities to develop yourself, to make it more beautiful. See, that is the difference between this. So, Matthew Arnold says, this is more sound, seems sound. Both are beneficent, beneficial for humans. Beneficial influences. So the stress of Hellenism is on intelligence, and the stress of Hebraism is on firm obedience of law. Both are necessary for development of human, the human spirit, the human personality. Both are august and inviolable. August and inviolable. But what you have to do is, you have to take the best. It's up to you. You have got an option. If you think that Hebraism is good for you, okay, you follow. If you think that Hellenism is good for you, follow that. If you think that both are necessary, you can follow that also. Options are there for you. But ultimate end is, the crowning aim is of saying or giving an account of both these forces. One representing the Semitic race, Hebraism, and the other representing the Greek people. It's only your right reason. This perfection, your perfection, your right reason, and also you have got what we call the sweetness and light. Disciplining yourself. Of course, without order, you cannot do anything. So, universal order and also universal sweetness and light together make you a very happy and perfect human being. As you can see later in history, this again observations made by Matthew Arnold, Christianity is the triumph of Hebraism. Renaissance is the triumph of Hellenism. Now you understand what is false. Christianity is the triumph of Hebraism, but Renaissance is the triumph of Hellenism. So you can see now. Because one is, the Hellenism is all about revival in art and literature, fine arts and all those, all the fine things in life. And then you also see Reformation. Reformation is actually Word of God centered Reformation. Although it is, as the historians say, it is a child of Renaissance. But it's Word of God centered. So again, that is Hebraism. And Puritanism, you know, that's because we have touched upon that also. It's a reaction against moral indifference, strictness again. Strictness, Hebraism. It's a real reaction against moral indifference, the moral fiber. Understand? So then, this is how Hebraism and Hellenism both work in the development of human beings, and you find the manifestations of this in history, in human history. Renaissance, Hellenism, and Christianity, Hebraism. Now, as I have already told you, my dear friends, this is not the view of a person like me, but this is, because there may be some people who may think that, why, what business I have to make, or I have to, what business I have to support Hellenism or Hebraism. I am not supporting any. I am saying that both are required. Mathew Arnold also finally says that both these forces are necessary. Both these forces together drive the empire of man. Ah, that's the thing. Underline that. Both these forces together drive the empire of man. And perfection leading to the perfection of his character. That is making him a cultured man, cultured person. A cultured being. I hope you have been following me. So once again, I am just going through the whole thing. Hebraism, Hellenism. Hebraism is from Semitic race or Semitic origin, means Jewish. Yes. Semitic Jewish. And Hellenism is of Indo-European origin. Indo-European means, you know, this Greek, Romans, French, Italian, India, we are also known. We are all Indo-European stock. So that is the difference. One deals with the moral laws, Hebraism, moral laws, and God is the spokesperson of that, of Hebraism. He has also, he has addressed a letter, the title is from, title of one of his epistles is this, to the Hebrews. So that itself shows that. So Saint Paul and his main concern is law. Establishment of law, establishing the law, means will of God. But at the same day, what happens when you find the Old Testament and New Testament put together, there is loaded with the sin, the concept of sin and punishment and penance and atonement, and all those things. Then Hellenism is all beauty and all beauty or development or clear reason, look at things as they are, enjoyment and things like that. But both, of course, there should be limits. Both limits put together, you make a wonderful human being, a cultured human being. A cultured human being. I think it is clear. Yes. And then you see history. Very briefly, if you go through, you will find what is Christianity? Triumph of Hebraism. What is Renaissance? Triumph of Hellenism. Bye. Have a nice time. Hope you have been following and enjoying my classes. Right? Now we have next lecture will be on chapter. This is comparatively a simple and also a small chapter. And two ideas already we have seen. Both are required also we have seen. The next chapter is on still one thing is necessary. Unum est necessarium. That is Latin. Poro unum est necessarium. Already I think you remember the introduction now, but unum means one. One thing necessary. Still one thing necessary. What is that one thing necessary? We will see the next one or two lectures and the conclusion, and that will be over, and soon we will take up immediately after this. I think we are planning to take up archetypal criticism by Northrop Frye. What are the ideas? Because a student has asked me to do it for their gentlemen or gentle ladies, maybe, I forgot who, for seminar purpose. So that I think that the next preference will be given to that. Now if some of you are interested in any your topics of interest, please let me know so that I can go according to your necessity and your needs instead of taking up subjects of my choice. So if you can, if you somehow let me know what you are interested in, what you want me to do, etc., I'll be ready to oblige you, provided you give me time. I require some time for preparation. That's all. Well, I think it's about 40 days or so ago that student asked me to take a few classes on archetypal criticism. And now I am only getting ready, still something more to be done. And after that, I think that somebody had asked me to do few lectures on feminism. That also I'll be doing, but I require time for this. That is the point. Okay, so if you have got any new ideas or any demands of yours, I will be really happy to accommodate your demands in my channel. And so you can also, and therefore, I would suggest that you subscribe also, share, and also tell your friends to do the same thing. Okay, so that will be fine. Bye.